The great one of Mahishi proffered as a blessing by the saint of Mantralaya. Sri Satyabodha was free from mental turmoil the next day. After his morning rituals, he was waiting for Ramachandra's arrival. Ramachandra was approaching the Srimat, unaware whether he should be staying in the monastery itself or may have to return home. He prostrated in front of the Swami and later participated in that day's puja. He could see two new lamps of gold throwing their light in the puja setting of that day. After puja and Tirtha Prasad, the pontiff called Ramachandra and gave him some ghee, sanctified by the chanting of mantras. Neither Ramachandra nor the others in the Srimat could understand the reason for it. The next day too, it was done in the same manner. And it continued like that, Ramachandra taking it home and coming the next day and getting fresh ghee sanctified by the Swami. But after 10 days, precisely on the 11th day, when the Swami was handing over the ghee, the vessel slipped in that process, and at that stage, the pontiff told Ramachandra, "Don't go home today, stay here itself." And when Ramachandra prostrated and got up, the Swami drew his attention and told him, "Please receive this," handing him Mantrakshata after deep meditation. Yes, the previous night, Sri Satyabodha had been soulfully praying to Lord Rama and Guru Raghavendra, "Swami, I had, as Pitadhipati, proclaimed that I would be conferring sannyasa on Ramachandra, and it is up to you to bless its accomplishment by me. But he needs a long life for that, and so I am supplicating to you now my heart's desire, the fruition of which you should grace. Whatever is the balance of my mundane life, I would like to gift such period to Ramachandra, and it is this yearning of mine that you should fulfill, a grace that I implore you to extend to me. This should definitely be complied with, my Lord." As a result, in the early hours, Lord Rama appeared in the dream of Sri Satyabodha and enlightened him. Satyabodha light two lamps of gold and daily proffer to Ramachandra some ghee sanctified by mantras. One day's ghee has to be reckoned as 1 year duration. And when a break occurs in this practice, you should proffer Mantrakshata to Ramachandra, also telling him what holy name should be given to Ramachandra and what all had to be done following that, the dream dissipating there. Accordingly, when the ghee had been given for 10 consecutive days and on the 11th day, the vessel containing it slipped out of his hands, Sri Satyabodha understood that he had another 10 years to live. Instantly, he decided to gift away those 10 years to Ramachandra, unmindful of his mundane existence coming to a close earlier than the predetermined time. Sri Satyabodha was of the strong conviction that his words should not be falsified. So scrupulous he was in his adherence to the moral code of life. The pontiff called aside Ramachandra and apprised him all these happenings. Ramachandra's eyes were in tears on hearing what the Swami was telling him. "Swami, what my mother had done was a kind of sacrifice, and the action of my wife was more admirable than that. And what you are now causing to occur is something peerless. Gifting one's remaining lifetime is indeed a supreme sacrifice," Ramachandra uttered most emotionally. Sri Satyabodha later prayed to Sri Hari and formalized the gift of 10 years of his remaining lifetime to Sri Ramachandra. We have seen about gifting of one's longevity in another episode covered in part 7. Sri Gopaldasa, it may be recalled, had gifted 40 years of his remaining lifetime to Jagannath Dasa in 1769 AD, consequent upon which the latter had lived up to 1809 AD and accomplished outstanding deeds in the extended term of his mundane life. In a like manner, in 1783 AD, Sri Satyabodha gifted the remaining 10 years of his life to Ramachandra. Undoubtedly, such extraordinary deportment being possible only for the best amongst the self-sacrificing ones. That evening itself, during the benedictory address, the pontiff made the official proclamation of granting sannyasa ashrama to Ramachandra. It was formalized later, and Ramachandra was given the holy name Satyasandha by Sri Satyabodha. Having gifted away his longevity, Sri Satyabodha in the next 2 days got affected by a severe illness and was squirming in agony. Sri Satyasandha could not bear the pain in his heart caused by his guru's worsening condition and lamented, "Swami, I cannot see you suffering such distress in consequence of gifting me your longevity. Don't cry. I am at the height of my happiness only now. May you become a celebrity while occupying this pita. I am departing from this mundane world tomorrow," said Satyabodha, consoling Sri Satyasandha. But the disciple wept like a child, unable to control his grief. The next day, Sri Satyabodha was made to sit, and when Abhisheka was being performed to him in veneration, his hand dropped on Sri Satyasandha in the act of blessing him. Sri Satyasandha could understand its significance instantly and called a disciple to hold Sri Satyabodha in position and quickly moved away from the scene, unable to repress the torment in his heart. Sometime after Sri Satyabodha had entered the Brindavana, Sri Satyasandha started on a yatra to Kashi, being aware that he had not many years to live. Before commencement of the journey, he went to see his mother to take leave of her. Unaware that her son would be living another 10 years only, she asked with motherly affection, "Why should you undertake Kashi Yatra at such a young age, please?" To which Sri Satyasandha replied, "Amma, when I was in your womb, you had longed to go to Kashi and organize Bhagavata Saptaha there. And it is only to fulfill that desire of yours I'm going there now, causing extreme joy to Bharti Bai." The mother could realize then what a great jnani her son was, to have known her desire even as he was in her womb, and recall it later and embark on a yatra as a sequel to fulfill that craving of hers as a dutiful son. She felt proud of his greatness and rude about her having thought earlier that he belonged only to her and to the small family circuit in regard to one who was to become a spiritually exalted personage and a great preceptor to the world. She also reflected that it was quite befitting that her son had turned to sainthood. "Amma, please bless me a successful yatra." "You are the one born to show the way to others," said Bharti Bai as parting words, and Sri Satyasandha departed from there on his journey to Kashi. On the way to Kashi, Sri Satyasandha performed several miracles at various places. Just as Sri Satyabodha had installed an Anjaneya idol at the Uttaradhimat premises in Tiruvallikeni, Chennai, Sri Satyasandha too had the opportunity of installing one such idol opposite Sri Parthasarathi Swami temple near the Kairavini Pushkarini in the same area. To this day, the street there is called as Hanumantarayan Koil Street. Continuing his journey, Sri Satyasandha reached Kashi via Vijayawada. He had darshan of Sri Bindu Madhava, Sri Kashi Vishwanatha, Visalakshi, Annapurni and Vyasa Kashi and discoursed on Bhagavata for 168 hours at a stretch, like what Sukracharya had imparted to Parikshit Maharaja. Hearing that, Ganga Devi herself made her presence felt there at that time and blessed Sri Satyasandha. And Sri Satyasandha offered to Ganga Devi a golden platter full of diamonds and precious stones. When the Swami reached Gaya, the penurious ones there, having come to know of his extraordinary deeds in Kashi, supplicated to him that they should be made affluent by the showering of gold, and only after that His Holiness should proceed for the Vishnupada Darshan. To achieve their object of preventing the Swami going for that darshan, they locked up Sri Satyasandha in a secluded confine. But by His supernatural powers, the Swami caused its unlocking and had darshan of the Vishnupada. During His Sanchara, the pontiff was in the vicinity of Pandharpur. He had to pass by a village there, and in a zamindar's house on the way, Pad Puja, Bhiksha and Mudradharana, branding of religious marks, had been arranged. A young boy sporting the Urdhvapundra Namas, religious marks, came inside then in great hurry. He demanded that he should be permitted to have the branding of the religious marks done on his person. It was complied with, and the Zamindar then invited him to have Teertha Prasad with others. "No, please, many people are waiting for me. Tomorrow you too can come to Pandharpur with the Swami. I shall take Teertha Prasad there," he told the host and left the place in great haste. Instantly, some devotees there commented, "He ought to have prostrated before the pontiff when he came in for the branding of the mudras. At least while leaving the place after Mudra Dharana, he should have done it in obeisance to the Pitadhipati. At a young age, all these civilities are perhaps lost sight of." Sri Satyasandha departed for Pandharpur the next morning, and when he was at the entry point to the town, the officials of the Pandrinatha temple management were awaiting there to receive the Swami with customary honours. When the pontiff's entourage was wondering how its movement to Pandharpur was known to the temple authorities, the officials concerned appraised the Swami that Lord Pandrinatha had enlightened in a dream about His Holiness arriving there and had ordained them to receive him with due honours, stunning everyone in the group. And when Sri Satyasandha and others went for darshan of the deity, they were in for another surprise. Yes, on the shoulders of Lord Pandrinatha, Shankha and Chakra markings could be seen clearly. The disciples of the Srimat and the devotees present with them exclaimed in ecstasy, "O Lord, was it you who came in great haste yesterday and had the Mudra Dharana? While a doubt may arise here as to why the Lord would have wantonly gone to a sannyasi to have the branding of the religious marks done on his person, just to make it known that he had presented himself there, the real cause for it lies elsewhere. In fact, it is to make it known that the branding of the Tapta Mudras by the holy hands of the Guru is as important as applying the Gopi Chandana Namas that the Lord had chosen to indulge in such act for the knowledge of the devotees. Sri Panduranga's mysterious deeds are not a few in number. Readers who have perused the episode on Pundrika covered in part 7 have requested me to pen a separate work on Sri Panduranga, and God willing, it will be my endeavour to complete it during my lifetime. Sri Satyasandha was touring places for months together and reached Savanur again. After having darshan of his guru, Sri Satyabodha's Moola Brindavana, and worshipping him there for some days, he started his journey towards Shimoga. After covering Shimoga, while travelling towards Teerthahalli, his mind was drawn towards Mahishi on the Tungabhadra River, located in the midst of a forest. The mysterious divine acts that had taken place at that holy spot occupying his thoughts. Sri Satyasandha, aware that his days were numbered, longed to visit Udupi to have darshan of Sri Udupi Krishna, installed there by Sri Madhvacharya. In those times, travelling through Mahishi was the shortest route to Udupi, as crossing the river reduced the distance considerably. Besides, Mahishi was a place famed for pandits and learned men resident there, and vidwans and heads of mutts used to halt there en route to Udupi. The Tungabhadra River, with copious flow and the forest in the vicinity, provided an ambience that attracted the learned pandits to meet there often and engage themselves in religious debates. Sri Satyanatha Tirtha, a contemporary of Sri Raghavendra Swami, during his sanchara was lured by the ambience of Mahishi and decided to spend some time there. During the period of his stay in that holy place, there were polemics on religious matters that were of the highest order, involving pandits par excellence. Though Sri Satyanatha visited Udupi and several other sacred places thereafter, yet he was fascinated most by Mahishi Kshetra and was desirous of establishing something of a long-lasting value there. Later, he expressed his longing to his disciple Sri Satya Abhinava Tirtha, suggesting that some commemorative schemes, permanent in nature, should be implemented there. The disciple had this in mind for a long time. Of course, the time for it came, though belatedly, and Sri Satya Abhinava Tirtha acquired for the Srimad the place where Sri Satyanatha Tirtha had sat and indulged in religious debates. Besides, around 1700 AD, he installed an idol of Sri Satyanatha Tirtha at that spot and also established a residential colony around the place called as Satyanatha Agrahara. Sri Satyasanta had during his sanchara reached Mahishi of such fame. He was desirous that even after going to Udupi, he should get back to Mahishi, and the idol of Sri Satyanatha too seemed to be casting a smiling look at him, rather meaningfully suggestive of that. Sri Satyasandha prayed to Sri Satyanatha from the depth of his heart, venting out, "O Abhinava Chandrikacharya, your holiness, as also your disciple, have caused the establishment of a branch of our Srimat here. This place is to my liking too, and I do not have the mind to move out from here. But my heart is pining to have darshan of that Udupi Krishna who had come there for the sake of our preceptor Sri Madhvacharya all the way from Dwarka. Most of the period gifted to me by my guru as the extended longevity of my mundane existence is already over, and for my permanent resting only you should show me the way, Gurudeva." And lo, at that time Sri Satyasandha felt a sigh quaking of the earth there. The Swami realized at that point of time that the idol of Sri Satyanatha was slowly moving away from its place towards the edge of the sanctum, where it stopped suddenly, ensconcing itself there. Sri Satyasandha, realizing that it signified what he wanted as an enlightenment from the Guru, that is, that it was undoubtedly the place for his resting after the completion of his mundane life, started on his yatra to Udupi without spending more time at Mahishi. On the way, he had darshan of Yelagur Anjaneya, and after worshipping that deity, when he started from there to continue his yatra, Sri Hanuman accompanied him during the journey, as evidenced by what the priest of that temple had been enlightened. In a dream, the divine being conveying to him that puja could be performed there after another 7 months, and that he was going with Sri Satyasandha to Udupi. In Udupi, Sri Satyasandha felt that days were running fast as he was engaged most of the time in the darshan and worship of Sri Krishna. He performed several mysterious deeds in Udupi too, and ere long realized that he had only 15 days of mundane life, and so started from there towards Agumbe to reach Mahishi, bearing in mind what Sri Satyanatha had enlightened him. On the bank of the river Sita, he conferred sannyasa ashrama on one Haveri Krishnachar, giving him the holy name Satyavrata, and made necessary arrangements for his occupying the august pita of the mud after him. He apprised Satyavrata that he had only 2 days mundane existence, and that after his predetermined end, his mortal remains should be taken to Mahishi and interred in a Brindavana to be installed there, at the spot indicated by Sri Satyanatha Tirtha. The Mula Brindavana of Sri Satyasandha, thus installed and consecrated in Mahishi, can be had darshan of at that holy place. The Panchaloka Vigraha of Sri Satyanatha Tirtha that had moved aside, thereby indicating the place for the installation of Sri Satyasandha's Brindavana, can now be had darshan of at Sri Jayatirtha Vidyapita, Bangalore, perched on the Brindavana of Sri Satyadhyana Tirtha. Mahishi is a thick forest area. Proximate to Sri Satyasandha's Brindavana, there are no houses or colony now. For any requirement, one should trek 5 or 10 kilometer distance. The Tungabhadra river there never dries up and is a broad stretch of free flowing water. When the flow is less and the river is not expansive, sand quarrying is done in the riverbed, such rights being taken on a lease basis by the contractors engaged in that pursuit. During the season when such excavation is done, the stretch adjoining the bank of the river in the riverbed becomes hollow on account of the quarrying. But later, when there is copious flow of water in the river, the hollow expanse gets filled with sand. As mentioned elsewhere, this can happen only in a flowing river, but such occurrence in the Gopi Talab seen in an earlier chapter is undoubtedly something divine. One can certainly experience the peace and calm of Mahishi if at least a 2-day stay there is planned and carried through. Mahishi will create in our mind an inexplicable kind of joy, which should only be experienced than heard about. Sri D.L.S. Achar and his family members explained to me about the glory of the place, hosting me and my group during all our 3 visits to that place. At my request, Sri Achar once discoursed on Sri Satyasandha at the Ainavaram Mutt in Chennai, a talk that was scintillating and awe-inspiring. Sri Satyatma Tirtha, the present Pitadhipati of Sri Uttaradi Mutt, during a visit to Chennai, blessed me and graced me by clarifying many of the doubts with the crisp answers, which I am beholden to acknowledge here. To this day, the practice of chanting the immortal stotra composed by Sri Appannacharya on Sri Raghavendra Guru, beginning as Sri Purnabodha, is punctuously followed while doing Abhisheka to the Brindavana of Sri Satyasandha in recognition of the grace extended by Sri Raghavendra Guru in proffering to humanity such a great preceptor. Sri Satyasandha's life story underscores the efficacy of Sankalpa Seva to Sri Raghavendra, bringing to the fore that the intensity of one's bhakti and concentration will bestow as his grace commensurate benefits. Madhvacharya and Bharti Bai had performed rigorous seva from dawn to dusk without food or rest, praying for a precocious child to be born as their son. And in answer to their supplication, Sri Raghavendra had blessed them the birth of an offspring of such excellence, who had later shone as Sri Satyasandha Tirtha. Thus, that it is soulful devotion born out of unflinching faith that earns for us the grace of Sri Guru Raja, which could even exceed our expectation, is laid bare in the life story of Sri Satyasandha, whose parents had prayed for a prodigious son to be born to them, but had been blessed with not only such an offspring, but one who later turned out to be a celebrity, a preceptor par excellence. In the calmness and peace of Mahishi, one can experience the lightening of one's heart, the serene atmosphere there providing such tranquility of the mind. Mahishi can be reached from both Shimoga and Udupi. In the Shimoga Tirthahalli route, Malur is at a distance of 45 km from Shimoga. A right turn from there and thereafter travel for another 6 km will lead one to Mahishi. From Mahishi, Tirthahalli is 23 km and from the latter place another 7 km journey will lead one to Bhimanakatte, the place where Bhima had raised a dam. Udupi is 3 hours journey from Mahishi via Malur, Tirthahalli and Agumbe. I am desirous of writing an exclusive work on Mahishi, where several mysterious happenings have taken place right from the Treta Yuga, covering also the glories of Sri Satyasandha, the illustrious one given to us by the saint of Mantralaya. I pray to Sri Guru Raja to bless me this privilege. Unlike Sri Satyasandha, I am not aware of my longevity, and if I should have any enlightenment about it, I can at least plan my future writings suitably. Only if Sri Hari makes this known, a few can have such inkling. But if such knowledge of one's longevity be ubiquitous, whether the world would be leading to, and why should there be disputes and clashes? Conflicts are of different types, and the mental combat in me is of three distinct categories. Such pressures are built around my personal life, my writing profession, and my struggle for others' causes. I cannot certainly plead about these to anyone else except Sri Guru Raja. But the result of such prayers, the various Raghavendra and the various experiences arising out of those, the grace of Sri Raghavendra and the lessons I learn from such exposures are truly wondrous. We are to see one such encounter in the next chapter.